Buenos días, amigas y amigos. Tengo el gusto y el honor de presentarles al profesor Clark Barrett. Clark hizo sus estudios de pregrado en la Universidad de Harvard en biología. Posteriormente se fue a la Universidad de California en Santa Bárbara, donde hizo un doctorado en antropología. Y los temas que trabaja están más cercanos a lo que se llamaría psicología evolutiva. Es decir, lo que le interesa es ver cómo los procesos cognitivos humanos, especialmente la cognición social, o sea, el procesamiento de la formación social, es el producto de la evolución y se ha ido desarrollando a lo largo de millones de años en nuestra especie. Pero ustedes verán que Clark Barrett es un profesor paradigmáticamente interdisciplinario. Es decir, se ha dado cuenta de esto que nosotros también tenemos bastante claro, que hay temas en el mundo académico contemporáneo que no pueden seguir siendo estudiados solo por una disciplina, ya sea la biología o la psicología o la antropología o la filosofía o la lingüística, sino por varias disciplinas al mismo tiempo, porque son territorios transdisciplinarios. Hoy día nos va a dar una conferencia que se titula Cerebros antiguos en el mundo moderno. Esta conferencia es organizada por la Facultad de Estudios Generales Letras y el Grupo Interdisciplinario de Investigación Mente y Lenguaje, que precisamente trabaja estos temas transdisciplinarios. Entonces, le doy la palabra al profesor Barrett, quien va a hablar en inglés, y posteriormente tendremos algún tiempo para preguntas y comentarios.
Bueno, primeramente, quiero agradecerle a Pablo por la invitación. En verdad es un honor para mí poder hablar aquí a ustedes y al grupo de Mente y Lenguaje. Ahora voy a pasar a inglés. I'm going to begin with an example to give you an idea of the phenomenon that I'm talking about. A few months ago, there was a performance at a music festival in California, the Coachella Music Festival, which is now one of the world's largest music festivals, attended by almost 100,000 people, in which these two people performed. On the left is Snoop Dogg, one of the world's most famous rappers. And on the right is Tupac Shakur, also one of the world's most famous rappers, but who's been dead for over a decade. At this festival, these two people performed together. Snoop Dogg gave a live performance, and Tupac Shakur gave a dead performance. He was projected as a hologram onto a screen and performed electronically, or was controlled electronically, his image on a screen. And I think it's safe to say that this is probably the first time, almost certainly the first time in human history, in which a live rapper performed with a dead rapper and was seen by tens of thousands of people. Now, as Pablo was mentioning, my field of study is evolutionary psychology. And in evolutionary psychology, we study the mind as a set of computational mechanisms. The analogy that's frequently given is to software running on neural hardware, the hardware of our brains, that has evolved over long periods of evolutionary time. And one of the premises of evolutionary psychology is that the software of our brain has a long evolutionary history. And of course, if it's been shaped by evolutionary processes, those processes occurred in the past. And therefore, to many people, this kind of situation poses a particular problem for evolutionary psychology, because it's clear that our brains are not, for example, designed to interact with a holographic projection of other human beings. And so on at least one view of human evolution, when Snoop Dogg's brain, when the computer in Snoop Dogg's brain is confronted with a moving image of a dead person, you might expect something like this to occur: a blue screen, a failure to compute. His brain is not designed to handle this kind of information, and therefore you might expect that if his brain is like a computer, it should simply fail to process the information. But of course, that's not what happened at this performance. Snoop Dogg and Tupac performed as if there was nothing particularly unusual about the situation. Now, you might think that I've given you an extreme example of what I'm going to be calling evolutionary novelty, meaning new information that is new or situations that are new from an evolutionary point of view that have never before occurred in the past. Clearly, this is a situation that's evolutionarily novel. It's never happened before, although given the way technology is going, this will probably happen more and more. I'm expecting to see some electronic Elvis, electronic John Lennon. We'll probably have many performances like this. But at this time, of course, it's new. And you might say, well, this is a very unusual example. But as anthropologists have pointed out, we're actually surrounded by evolutionary novelty all the time, including in this room. It's a normal thing for humans to be able to deal with situations that have never before occurred. So one example is the kinds of social environments that we live in are in many ways evolutionarily unprecedented. We live surrounded by many, many more people than would normally be the case in most ancestral environments. In Lima, you have 10 million people. Every day, you interact with people that you've never seen before and that you will never see again. Where I do my field work, which is in the Ecuadorian Amazon, the villages are of several hundred people. And you might know up to 1,000 people or a few hundred people that you will see during your life, but you certainly aren't going to interact with tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands or millions of people in the course of your life. And the situations that we interact in are also unusual as well. So not just the number of people, but the kinds of contexts in which we interact and seem to do more or less fine. Our brains don't simply stop working. On the personal level, too, there's a lot of evolutionary novelty. Good examples can be found in the domain of artifacts, human-made devices. So cases where we're able to use some kind of a tool or artifact to interact with the world in ways that were not possible before. Things like using an electronic device to control an avatar of yourself, a version of your body that's present in a computer environment. Of course, that's never before happened in human history. And interaction with things like the internet, computers, and so on. Evolutionarily novel, and yet somehow our brains manage to process them okay. So, from at least one perspective, looking at evolutionary psychology, this presents a kind of puzzle or paradox. And here I'm giving you the definition of paradox from the Oxford English Dictionary. A statement or proposition which, despite sound or apparently sound reasoning from acceptable premises, leads to a conclusion that seems logically unacceptable or self-contradictory. So here's a premise. Adaptations can only have been shaped by objects, situations, cues, events, information that existed at some point in the past. That premise seems very hard to dispute. There's no question that evolution is a process that happened in the past. It could be happening right now, but certainly the majority of what is responsible for the design of our brains stretches back hundreds, thousands, millions of years. So that seems true. From that, we might conclude that any capacity of humans to deal with objects, situations, cues, and events that did not exist until now or very recently cannot be due to adaptations. Remember, the idea of an adaptation is some bit of brain machinery or some brain mechanism that was shaped by natural selection, evolutionary forces operating in the past. Many people would conclude this from this. But I don't know if you'd regard this as logically unacceptable, but certainly it seems unlikely to be true that when I'm interacting with the internet, or when Snoop Dogg is interacting with Tupac Shakur on stage, that there are not adaptations in our brains that are involved in explaining our behavior and our thinking. This doesn't seem to be an acceptable conclusion that we'd like to draw from this premise. And so it's a puzzle, or a paradox, if you will. Now, the standard solution to this problem is this. Many anthropologists and psychologists would like to say that our ability to deal with novel circumstances must involve adaptations, but they cannot be adaptations, quote unquote, for those things. They must be adaptations for something else. And the two major categories that you have are either quote-unquote general purpose adaptations, and when I say general purpose, that generally means they're not adaptations for anything in particular except perhaps being flexible. Or what is sometimes called exaptations, adaptations that are for one thing but then get borrowed and used for something else. That's the standard solution. And one of the reasons why people like that solution, it comes from a very popular view of the mind as being composed of two different kinds of things. Either part of the mind is composed of specialized adaptations, and many psychologists view specialized adaptations as being like this. They handle only very narrow kinds of information. They're often unconscious. We can't change them through conscious thinking. They're often isolated. They don't interact with each other. They're inflexible and innate. And so on this view, if my adaptations evolved in the past, then the modules in my brain right now are going to be the same as the modules that would have been present in someone a million years ago or 200,000 years ago. No change whatsoever because they're innate. They're not affected by my environment, and they can't interact with new things. If you think that, then you might think, well, there has to be another kind of thing, which is general purpose, interactive, so mechanisms that can interact with new information, that are flexible, and that involve learning. And so a typical solution to this problem is to say, well, evolution creates this part, and this is what keeps us locked in the evolutionary past. And then on top of that, we have some very, very flexible general purpose mechanisms that are the kinds of things that allow Tupac to interact with Snoop Dogg, or that allow me to use the internet. So that when I use the internet, I'm not using these, I'm only using this. This is actually a fairly common view in psychology. You also see it, for example, in Daniel Kahneman's recent book, Thinking Fast and Slow, where you have this reasoning system, the flexible bit in the middle, and then you have the modular, rigid adaptations that are on the periphery. In fact, there are evolutionary psychologists who argue this as well, that this is how we need to think about it. Here's a quote from Chappé and MacDonald. They argue that, these are evolutionary psychologists, mechanisms of general intelligence and domain general learning are powerful tools designed to solve problems not recurrent in the EEA. The EEA here means the environment of evolutionary adaptedness. You can think of this as the evolutionary past that shaped adaptations. I'm not going to read this whole thing, but they point out it's difficult to see how humans could solve new problems, novel problems, or how they could solve recurrent problems in novel ways, because there's no characteristic input-output relationship based on past recurrences that can solve them. Okay, so the logic is, when you're in an evolutionarily novel situation, like logging onto Facebook, okay, that situation is so new that there is nothing in the evolutionary past that maps onto that new situation. Therefore, you need some kind of general purpose mechanisms to explain it. And I want to point out here, you know, I mentioned the idea of a puzzle or paradox. This very statement is paradoxical because it uses the word designed to solve problems not recurrent in the EEA. And when you think about how evolution works, we use design as a metaphor, right? So natural selection is a designer. Something can only be designed by natural selection if it did exist in the EEA. There's no such thing as an adaptation that can be designed to deal with situations that have never happened. And so there's a problem in this formulation. If there are adaptations, even if they're general purpose, they have to have been shaped in the past. So the questions I want to raise in this talk are twofold. First, is it true that when we interact with evolutionary novel situations, it's always because of domain general mechanisms? There's never specialized adaptations involved. And I'm going to say probably not. It's not always the case. And second, when mechanisms handle novelty adaptively, is it because they were not designed to solve problems present in the past, or should we entertain another possibility? Maybe they are solving problems that existed in the past and that still exist today. Okay, so think about the case of Tupac. Yes, he's dead. Okay, yes, Tupac is a hologram being controlled by a computer. But Snoop Dogg's eyes, when he looks at Tupac, they're functioning just like they were designed to function, right? The visual experience of Tupac that he's having, it's evolutionarily new in certain ways, but his eyes are working just like you would expect them to be, right? Let's say that he coordinates his dancing with Tupac. Yes, it's true that Tupac is dead and is not a real person, but the mechanisms of his bodily reactions that he's using to dance along with this other dead person may in fact be doing just what they were designed to do, right? And so we need to entertain this possibility that in cases of flexibility, it may be that the mechanisms are not exaptations. They're not being used for some purpose that they weren't designed for. They're actually still being used for the purpose that they were designed for. It's just that there are some aspects of the situation that are new. So I'm not going to propose that there's no such thing as domain general mechanisms, or that there's no such thing as general purpose mechanisms. What I'd like to make a weaker claim, which is we shouldn't just automatically assume that when a situation is evolutionarily novel, the only explanation can be domain general mechanisms. We need a second category of explanation, which is to think about how adaptations shaped in the past interact with a new situation. And sometimes it can be adaptive, sometimes it can be maladaptive. There are likely to be adaptations involved whenever we handle novelty adaptively. We might use language like domain general or domain specific if we want, but we can't avoid talking about, well, what are those mechanisms? What did they evolve to do? We could say it's general or specific, but just saying something's general escapes the duty that we have as scientists to describe what's going on. So we need to confront this issue of what are the mechanisms, what's their function. And what we really want to adopt is a view that is not present in the dualist conception of modules that I gave you before, which is we want to talk about interactions. Generally, when psychologists think about modules, they think about things that really aren't designed to interact. They just do the same thing no matter what. And what we want to think of instead is adaptations do interact with the world, and they behave differently depending on the circumstances, perhaps, and that's what we need to think about. And so I want to adopt a slightly different perspective on how the mind and the world interact. So the mind, you have here the mind, and it's in a body, right? So we're not just talking about brain in a vat, we're talking about a brain in a body that's interacting with the world. And you have the world. Now, often the way that this interaction is conceptualized could be summarized as something like this. You have the brain, and the brain is whatever it is. And then you have the world, and the world is whatever it is. And the relationship between them is something like adding what's ever in the world into the brain. So the brain doesn't change, the world doesn't change, we just add them together in some way. That's a fairly typical way of conceiving of things. I want to propose, though, that this is kind of a mathematical function, addition. The function that describes the interaction between the mind and the world is actually likely to be much more complex than addition. It's not the case that we just take the brain, it's a static thing, it's frozen in the evolutionary past, and we just add in some information from the world. Instead, the world affects how the brain develops, and the brain affects the world through things like culture and so on. And so when we think about the example I gave at the beginning of a live person interacting with a hologram, human minds are actually shaping how that hologram was built. And that hologram, like many human-made artifacts, is actually designed to interact with our mental mechanisms and to interact with them in a way that produces essentially a normal kind of outcome. Think about other artifacts, like a computer keyboard. That is intentionally designed by humans to be able to interact with the way that our bodies and minds work. So it's not just any aspect of the world. There's actually a complex set of interactions between minds and worlds. And there's many ingredients of evolutionary thinking that we need to understand this complex interaction between minds and worlds. Today, because I'm limited in time, I just want to give you essentially two new ingredients to think about that aren't usually discussed in evolutionary psychology. And so I'm going to be talking about these two ingredients in turn. The first one, reaction norms, and the idea of homologs or evolutionary relatives, mechanisms that share a common ancestry, evolutionary ancestry. And then I'm going to turn at the end of the talk to what I'm going to call inductive bets, and I'll explain what I mean by each of these. So first, the idea of a reaction norm. This is an idea from evolutionary biology, which simply refers to plasticity or flexibility of development. And frequently, this is a typical kind of graph that you would get of a reaction norm in biology. So the way that what this shows is how some aspect of the phenotype of an organism, like body size, for example, changes developmentally as a function of the environment. So this would show, for example, that maybe if I grow up in a slightly colder environment, I might end up with a larger body size than if I grow up in a slightly warmer environment. And you can also have an additional dimension, which is, say, how body size changes with age. So think of a complex curve. This is different than the idea of thinking that all designed aspects of organisms that are designed by evolution have to be exactly the same in all individuals. This is showing that, well, some individuals may be bigger than others because there is a mechanism, a developmental mechanism, that is designed to make you have a larger body size at lower temperature. This is a typical kind of conception in biology. Now, when we transport this into psychology, you could imagine something like this. So people study, for example, how personality might change as a function of the environment that you grow up in. Of course, there's elements of personality that may not be changed by your developmental environment, but you could easily imagine that humans that grow up in, say, a stressful environment or an environment where there's more aggression might have more aggression as adults than kids that grow up in an environment where there's less aggression. That could be a kind of psychological reaction norm that could, in part, be a result of evolution. When we go into the realm of cognition, things get even more complicated. So this is a map showing the languages that are spoken in the northeastern Amazon region. Here's the Amazon River, Brazil, Venezuela. A very complex map showing that if you grew up here, this is the language that ends up being in your mind. If you grew up here, this is another different language that ends up being in your mind. In a sense, this shows the reaction norm of human development to the linguistic environment, right? There's flexibility. Is it the case that the different languages that you speak in these different places is entirely because of domain general mechanisms? Not necessarily. It could very well be that there are adaptations for language acquisition, which, as a normal part of their functioning, cause you to speak a different language depending on the environment that you grew up in. Okay, so, and that's the kind of thing that we want to think about when we think about specialized mechanisms that evolve to develop in a world with culture and cultural transmission. Are there reaction norms in the brain? I have a recent paper in which I discuss, you know, what reaction norms in the brain might look like. And often, we might think, typically, psychologists think of the causation of the arrow of causation is going this way. You're born with a certain set of genes. You experience certain kinds of environments, and that gives you the phenotypic outcome that you get. But we now know that brain development is not, and development of the body and the brain, depends heavily on how genes are expressed. And part of how reaction norms in the brain might work might be not only that genes are turned on during development that affect brain development, they get inputs, information from the world, and produce phenotypic outcomes, but causation could go the other way too, where information coming into your brain can actually turn on or off different kinds of genes. This is a difficult thing to study in humans, but there's increasing evidence from other animals that this is the case. So there was a great study recently with bumblebees, bees that go out foraging, that show that depending on the activity that the bee is engaging in, there's different genes turned on in the brain of the bee. So when the bee is looking for food, there's some genes turned on that are different than the genes that are turned on when it's mating, for example, suggesting that you can have causation going the other way. Information from the outside is actually changing how your brain develops. And in the case of when we want to think about specialized mechanisms in the brain, whether you want to call them modules or adaptations or whatever word you want to use, there may be different areas of the brain that have different reaction norms. So the visual area of your brain, there may be different genes turned on here that are affecting the development of vision that interact with information coming from the outside that are, say, different than genes that are turned on in areas that are dealing with language. And so it's not just that language and vision areas are innately specified, but rather there may be a very complicated interaction between how they develop and what information is coming in that is not necessarily entirely domain general. It could be quite specialized. These interactions could be quite carefully designed by evolution. There's some evidence for this. This is a study, recent study, showing co-expression patterns of over 2,000 genes. So what they did was they took brains of humans and chimps. These are people and chimps who had died. And there are techniques where you can look at what genes are expressed in different parts of the brain. And indeed, what you find is this is a very crude, this shows statistically how they found these correlation patterns, which I'm not going to go into. But basically what you find is that there are entire sets of genes that are turned on in some areas of the brain that are different than the sets of genes that are turned on elsewhere. Now, this doesn't necessarily show what I claimed, that the environment can be affecting them, but it's certainly consistent with the idea. And what's interesting is you see in human brains and chimp brains, because we're 99% genetically identical, right, the same genes are involved, and you see chimp brains and human brains have similarities, but they're not identical. There's differences. There's been modifications. How would this play out when we think about the development of evolved mechanisms, specialized adaptations in the brain? Well, what we might expect to see is that mechanisms become specialized, become shaped during development. Here's an example of a study looking at mechanisms for perception of faces. So there's a specialized area in the fusiform gyrus of your temporal lobe that responds specifically to human faces. That's different than what's called the parahippocampal place area. This area would be activated, in fact, it's activated in you all right now, when you show people pictures of a room or a space, like a room in their house. This is the area that you use to recognize, I'm in my bedroom right now, for example, or I'm in this lecture hall. And this would recognize the face of another person. What you see is that over the course of development, these start out occupying broad areas of the brain, and they become narrowed down with age. They become more and more specialized. And arguably, this could be due to a process of feedback, where at birth, you don't have these specialized areas. In infancy, you have relatively undifferentiated object recognition areas, which are receiving input from faces and from places. And that over the course of development, you have increasing ontogenetic specialization of these areas. And we wouldn't want to say, well, it's all because of the world or it's all because of genes in the mind. It's because of an interaction between genes that are maybe designed to build these areas, but they're making heavy use of information from the world in that specialization. And if that's the case, this is exactly the kind of pattern that you would expect to see. Many psychologists look at these kinds of evidence and they say, well, if modules are innate, if they're present at birth, then the fact that there's changes over the lifespan means that there can't be specialized mechanisms here. And what I want to argue is that that's not necessarily true. There's plenty of reasons to think that there's specialization, but that it's specialization that uses input from the world to build itself. I mentioned the idea of homology, and it's possible that the evolutionary origin of these mechanisms comes from a process that's sometimes known as duplication and divergence, where you have, if we went back to an ancient evolutionary ancestor, that ancestor might not have had face-specific recognition abilities in the brain, but it might have had more general object abilities, which over time, selection can shape those to be dedicated to particular classes of objects. so that what was initially perhaps an undifferentiated object recognition region over evolutionary time split into one that was dedicated to faces and one that was dedicated to places. And we may be seeing, I'm about to give you an example, of possible evolution in progress, where there's evidence that humans are capable of developing another area which is specialized for something evolutionarily novel, which is reading words. And I'm taking this example from the work of Stanislaus Dehaene and colleagues. I highly recommend this book, Evolution in the Brain, because it gives us an example, a very carefully worked out empirical example, of how evolved mechanisms that are specialized, interacting with evolutionarily new inputs, are creating brain systems that have an organization that makes sense. It's not just that they're domain general and completely flexible. There's a special kind of interaction between evolved design and the world. So what Dehaene and colleagues have found is an area also in the temporal lobes, near where you have these other object recognition areas, like the area for faces, called the visual word form area. They call it the visual word form area. And this shows the kind of activation patterns that you see in the brain of a literate person, someone who's able to read, when you show them words in an fMRI scanner. You would not see this in an illiterate person who could not read. So already we know that it's a function of the developmental environment that you grow up in. If you can read words, and I show you a word like novelty, this area of your brain will be activated specially for words. And what's interesting is you see a variety of interesting design features, like I can show you the word novelty in any font, and this area will still be activated. And that's interesting, right? So it's abstracting something because, for example, when you look at this letter L right here, perceptually that's totally different than this letter L. In fact, this whole word is perceptually not very similar to this word. But there's a level of processing in your brain that treats them as identical. It appears to be a kind of specialization. And there's in this book, there's a bunch of other interesting evidence for things that you would think of as design. It looks like it's engineered to read. But that creates a kind of paradox. How can you say there's a part of our brain that's engineered to read when reading is clearly evolutionarily novel? It's a couple of thousand of years old. We know from historical evidence that writing systems were invented in several places in the world, but not more than a few thousand years ago. And that's not very much time for evolution to create a new specialization. So how would we explain this? Well, the first part is that it's not a coincidence, I think, that this area is right next to where other object, specialized object recognition areas are. It's as if, sorry, to go back a couple slides, it's kind of a little, it's a cousin, right, that's branching off from these other object recognition areas through a kind of developmental process, suggesting that it's not just a domain general mechanism, but that it's actually making use of pre-existing machinery in your brain for recognizing objects, but that it's somehow getting used a little bit differently. The other factor that we need to think of is the world. Okay, so there's this mechanism in the brain that can build specialized object recognition abilities. And there's interesting evidence that letters have culturally evolved to fit the mind well. So I gave you the metaphor before of a computer keyboard, where it's pretty clear that that was invented by humans in order to fit our hands, right? The spacing of the keys on the keyboard, it works well with human fingers. It wouldn't work well for a dolphin. It wouldn't work well for a bat. It wouldn't work well for a frog. Keyboards work well for humans. And it wasn't necessarily, in the case of keyboards, it could be that there were individual inventors that said, okay, I'm going to create a device that is good for working for human hands. But we also know that cultural evolution processes can create design without necessarily being invented by a single person. They're the result of a population of people using artifacts, and the artifacts that work well survive better than the artifacts that don't. And so you can get design over time. And that seems to be what's happened with languages. This was a study by Mark Changizi and colleagues where they look at the junctions that are present in letters like Y. And it turns out that a Y junction like this is actually present right here. Well, it might not look like a Y to you, But if I stand here, this looks like a Y. Okay. And there's a Y right there. There's a Y right there. And so if you take pictures of the world, and Changizi looked at images of the world from the internet, you can actually have a research assistant count how many Y's there are in the picture, right? And then you can take a text, like a newspaper, and count how many Y junctions there are in those letters. And this is a graph showing what happened when they did that. These are the different kinds of junctions. And the dotted lines are letters, the frequency of those junctions in letters, and the solid lines are the frequency of those junctions in pictures, like of this room. And what you see is that the junctions that are the most common in letters are also the most common in the world. Very, very close mapping. Now, I find this incredibly surprising when I saw this. There could be different explanations for it, but Changizi's explanation, which I think makes a lot of sense, is that letters have evolved, not genetically, but through cultural transmission processes. The ones that our brains can see and distinguish easily get saved over historical time, and the ones that are harder for us to tell apart get thrown away. And so the written letters that we have are well designed to match the object recognition systems of our brains. A great example of a fit between an evolved mechanism, so object recognition, and then the cultural world that we live in. Suggesting that, you know, to me, this suggests the idea that, well, the letters are evolutionarily new, therefore we need to invoke domain general mechanisms, isn't quite right. There are some domain general mechanisms, but also object recognition, as we well know from psychological research, is very specialized processes. And so this looks like more like an interaction between a culturally evolved world and a specialized mind. And it's interesting that, of course, this mechanism for word perception only exists in people that can read. We could think of this maybe as the evolution of a new mechanism in progress, where we don't know how selection is acting on human minds, but it's conceivable that in 10,000 years, 20,000 years, this could become a specialized brain area that's present in all humans. And so the lesson from reaction norms is that I think the idea of modules that's present in psychology as being totally rigid and inflexible is likely to be, there may be some mechanisms in the brain like that, but most adaptations are not like that. Most adaptations have plasticity. And so the question for you as students, when you go out and do your research in psychology in the future, this is the question I think that you should be asking. How much of our modern thinking and behavior can be accounted for by these older evolved reaction norms confronting new environments? That's a very important question that people, because of this dualistic way of thinking, either specialized or general purpose, nobody's asking this, or very few people are asking this, and this is the question we should be asking. Okay, now let me turn to the last topic that I want to discuss, and here I'm going to give you two studies of my own. And this is a concept that I think is important for evolutionary thinking, and it's what I'm calling inductive bets. I made this term up. Both of these words exist, of course. Induction is an ancient philosophical idea, and the idea of a bet is obvious. But what an inductive bet is this. So you probably know, if you've taken philosophy classes, that induction is a process of making a general inference from specific cases. And the interesting thing about induction is that unlike deductive inference, where you can be certain of the conclusions, an inductive inference, you can never know if you're right for sure. And so here's an animal. Let's say that I were to point to this thing and say, that animal could hurt you. It's very dangerous. Stay away from it. If you believe me, right, then you're making an induction because this is a pangolin, by the way. It's called a pangolin. It's an anteater. It's a kind of anteater with these scales. It's very strange. It's from Asia. And you've probably never seen this before. And if you experience it once and it bites you, say, then you might develop a fear of everything that looks like this in the future. Now, do you know for sure that the next pangolin that you see is dangerous? You don't know for sure. But in fact, it would be a good bet. So you're making an induction You're making a generalization from a specific case. You only saw one pangolin and only ever bit you once, and from that you infer all pangolins are dangerous. Your brain is, in a sense, betting that that's a good inference to make. And what I want to argue is that all adaptations make inductive bets. We kind of don't know it, but your hand is making an inductive bet about the world. Not cognitively, right? But your hand is guessing that there are, you know, the design of your hand is making guesses about how to grab things. There's many examples from perception where your brain, in order to reconstruct three-dimensional space, is making guesses from incomplete information. Sometimes they can be wrong, but the evolutionary process shapes them to be, in general, good guesses, good bets. So this goes all the way down to bacteria. I'm arguing this is a general property of adaptation. Some bacteria have a property called what's called phototaxis, attraction to light. And this is a paper about the design of phototaxis in bacteria from the 80s. This shows the path that a bacterium is taking through the water. It's taking this path, and suddenly light is turned on here. The light is turned on at A, and when it's turned on, the bacteria changes direction and goes towards the light. It's a very simple idea, but you can show that there are some bacteria that like, quote-unquote, like light. Whether we want to say it's liking or not is an interesting philosophical question since they don't have brains, but they're definitely attracted to light, and some of them are repelled from light. This is an inductive bet. So in the design of the bacterium, it's betting that light is a good thing to go towards. Right? But what if the light is coming from a volcano? Right? And it goes into that volcano and dies. That's not a good bet. But the reason that this bet has been engineered into the bacteria is because light, where there's light, there's nutrients. And in some cases, these are photosynthetic bacteria, so they need light to actually get energy. And so usually it's a good bet, although it can, I mean, insects have phototaxis. If you turn on a light at night, you'll see moths and things come to the light. They're betting that that's a good thing to go towards, and in that case, they happen to be wrong because they'll probably die. But in the natural world, they're betting that that's a good thing to approach. And this is built into the design, so the interesting thing about these organisms is they have all kinds of little special features that are shaped to make them go towards light. And so that's an inductive bet. Now, I think this is important for us because our brains are making all kinds of inductive bets about the world. And what's interesting is the way our brains are designed, you put them in a new environment and they're going to make some bets. Sometimes they might be wrong, sometimes they might be right. And then the question is, we need theories that to think about, you know, why are they right when they're right and sometimes wrong? And what I want to argue is that in many cases, our capacity to deal with novelty well comes from the fact that the inductive bets built into our brains actually work pretty well for the world that we're in. Even though the world that we're in is new, my brain is betting that this is solid. I didn't evolve in a world with tables, so this table is evolutionarily new, but my bet that this is solid works for this. And in the same way, you know, the bets that Snoop Dogg's brain was making about electronic Tupac were right about Tupac, even though he was just a visual projection. So I want to give you two studies of my own to conclude that look at the bets that our minds make about the world. The first is a phenomenon known as the hot hand phenomenon. This has been studied in psychology since the 80s, and the hot hand refers to the belief that you are on a lucky streak. So it comes originally from basketball, people making free throws in basketball, where, this is data from the original study, this is actually Boston Celtics from 1981 to 1982, so many of you might not even know who these people are. But at that time, Larry Bird was a very famous basketball player, and he was the best free thrower on the Celtics. This is the probability of a hit following a miss. This is the probability of a hit following a hit. So this is the probability that he'll make a basket if his last one was failed. And this is the probability that he'll make a basket if the last one was successful. And what you want to look at is these players vary in how good they are at making free throws. So Larry Bird gets 90% of his free throws. Gerald Henderson, not so good. Rick Robey, even worse, 60%. But if you look down these columns, what you see is that actually, statistically, these are not different. Larry Bird made 90% of his baskets whether he just missed or whether he just had a hit. Similarly, there's slight variations, but they're essentially the same. So you have a hit rate, but whether you get a hit or a miss doesn't depend on the last throw. So it's almost like Larry Bird is flipping a coin that comes up heads 90% of the time and tails 10% of the time, but it doesn't matter what the last coin flip was. It's just 90% chance of getting a hit no matter what happened before. And what's interesting, though, is if you look at humans watching this, we think that when he just made a hit, his probability of getting a hit is higher. So this is data from their study that shows percentage of fans who rated Larry Bird as either shooting randomly or being on what's called a streak. This is the hot hand idea, that he's on a run of good luck. And this is called the probability of alternation. So 50% would be like a coin toss. And the smaller the number is, the lower the probability of alternating from a hit to a miss or a miss to a hit. So when you have low alternation probabilities, that means a hit followed by a hit. And when you have below 50, most of the fans thought that he was on a streak. But of course, as you know, if I toss a coin, I'm going to get two heads in a row a lot, or three heads in a row, or four heads in a row is very, very common. What this is showing is that when that happens, people think that they have a lucky coin. So the question here is, what is this for? It's a bet that our brains are making, right? And in that case, they're wrong. You're guessing, well, he just made a basket, therefore he's more likely to make the next basket. You're wrong. And if you're a gambler, you can be wrong in a very, very bad way, right? That costs you a lot of money. If you think that you just, you know, you just won a roulette thing, or in the slot machines you just got a hit, and then you say, oh, I'm putting more money in because I just got a hit, then you're going to lose a lot of money that way. That's a bet that your brain is making, but it's going to be wrong. So we wanted to ask, my colleague Andreas Vilka and I wanted to ask, is this just about sports, or is it a more general property of our brains? And if so, why are we making this dumb mistake? And so we thought to look at, so we thought, what over evolutionary time could explain why our brains are built this way? And the thing that occurred to us is foraging. Foraging for resources in general, and I mean resources in a very broad sense. So if you look at basketball free throws, or if you look at coin tosses, those are genuinely random. Getting one coin toss heads doesn't predict another coin toss. But if you're walking through the desert and you find a plant on the ground, right, so you've been dry desert sand, and then all of a sudden you find grass growing, you are actually more likely to find other grass growing nearby because you're near a water source. And if you look at natural resources, it turns out that they are not randomly, most of them are not randomly distributed across the environment. They come in clumps or streaks. Okay, so if you're walking through the desert and you find water, you're in a good place and you should stay there. So it's actually, in some cases at least, rational to say, well, now I'm going to put more money into the slot machine because now I know I'm in an area with water. Or I've just reached, you know, I've found one person and there's likely to be other people nearby. I've found some fruit on a tree. That means that there's likely to be other fruit on that same tree. So rather than going to the next tree, I should continue to look for fruit on this tree. This could be an area where it makes sense to have a hot hand. So we propose that hot hand might be a kind of default bet that our brains are making that comes from foraging. And we do it for basketball. We do it for the stock market, even though it actually doesn't work for the stock market. It doesn't work for basketball. There's actually been empirical studies showing it's not a good idea to invest in using this bet, but it might work for the natural world. So we did two experiments. One was with UCLA students, and what we wanted to see was, can we change how, first of all, does the expectation of hot hand, does it apply outside of basketball? Does it apply to the natural world? And we designed an experiment that had five kinds of resources. And these varied in a 2x2 design. Okay, so we compared natural versus artificial resources, thinking, well, maybe hot hand occurs more for natural resources than artificial resources. And we have them play a game where they see a resource pop up, like a ripe fruit, and then they have to say, well, will the next one be ripe or unripe? Will you find a ripe fruit in the next space? So imagine you're walking along a path, and in this spot you find a ripe fruit. Will the next one have a ripe fruit or not? We had fruits and birds' nests, and then we had artificial environments, which were bus stops and parking spaces. These are people from Los Angeles, remember, so they know what these are. So these vary in that the fruits and nests are natural, and the bus stops and parking spaces are artificial. They're man-made. Evolutionarily novel, by the way. And then we also had clumped versus dispersed. So fruits do come in clumps in the world, and parking spaces come in clumps in the world. I don't know how Lima is, but in Los Angeles, we have white curbs, which is where you can park, and we have red curbs where you can't. And if you look at parking meters, if you find a spot on the street where there's one parking meter, there's probably 10 in a row, spots where you can park, right? And then there's a long area where you can't park. And then there's another area where there's 10 parking spots, for example. You almost never see just a single parking spot. Those are clumped. And then dispersed, birds' nests are dispersed because birds are territorial. So they don't put their nests right next to each other. They space them out evenly. And the same with bus stops. I imagine this is true in Lima as well as Los Angeles. When you find one bus stop, it's a certain distance to the next bus stop, and it's a similar distance to the next bus stop. You don't find 10 bus stops right next to each other, followed by a long period with no bus stops. These are dispersed as opposed to clumped. So we have all these resources, and then we threw in coin tosses because those are genuinely random, and students should know, and you all should know, and I know, that there's no correlation between coin tosses. But as we'll see, you know that consciously, but your brain doesn't really know it. And remember, we use this measure called alternation probability. This is just so you can understand the graph I'm about to show you. And we call this subjective PA. So we take the data from students' guesses. I'm guessing a hit, I'm guessing a miss. We give them 100 in a row. Critically, all of them are just like coin tosses. It's just that they're all 50% and they're all uncorrelated, but the resource that they see is sometimes a fruit or sometimes a nest. And we from the data, we compute how often do they alternate their guesses and how often do they change their guesses. So if you always stuck with the same guess, like hit, your PA would be zero. You would never alternate. And if you change it every time, hit, miss, your PA would be one, because every time you're changing. And so the lower the PA, the more hot-handed they are. And if it's less than 0.5, they have a clumped assumption. Does that make sense? Here's the data for the UCLA students. This shows the alternation probability. This is 50%. And so the first thing to notice is, for every single resource, they have hot hand. There's no time do they go above 0.5. They're always below 0.5. Now, coins is the circles. That's about as that's as close to random 0.5 as they get, but they're still hot-handed about coins. And we interviewed these students, and they know that a coin is supposed to be 50%. I can pretty much guess that if any of us were to take this experiment, you would get this too, even though I could tell you that the coins are, you could tell me that the coins are 50%, your finger would still be guessing if you got heads, that it's a little bit more likely to get heads the next time. And so there's variation, and so what we found was several interesting effects. One thing that's very consistent with this resource idea is, if you get a hit, so if you get a ripe fruit, you're more likely to have hot hand. And that makes sense. Than if you get a miss, because think about if you're walking, like I said, if you're walking through the desert and you find water, you should stay there. So finding water means you should guess more water. Finding the absence of water, you shouldn't have that as strong of an effect, and that's what we found. And interestingly, there was a small effect of natural versus artificial, which I think you might be able to see here, that parking spots and bus stops, where are they? This one is bus stops. This one is parking. And the fruits are here, and the nests are here. So natural made it a little more clumpy than artificial. But you still see in these novel environments, it's still working. They're still making this bet. No effect of clump versus dispersed, interestingly. And then you can also see this is kind of going down, which is interesting. They were becoming more hot hand as the experiment progressed, even though there was no reason from the feedback they were getting to do that. It's almost like you're looking more for clumps as it goes along. Okay, and so the last thing I want to mention is I did this study at my field site in Ecuador. So this is a Shuar man, native Amazonian in southwest, they live in southwest Ecuador in the Amazon region. And what's relevant here is that UCLA students do not forage. They don't go around the environment hunting things that might come in clumps. But he does. So he found one toucan and shot it with a blowgun. And then there was another one right nearby, because when you see one toucan, you might be more likely to see another toucan in the same tree. So the question is, do they have hot hand? Does it take a similar form to Americans? And so, yeah, this is Ecuador. Here's Peru down here. And this study was done right around here in the Pastaza River. And I went, did the same thing. This is a game that you play on a laptop computer, and you just have two buttons to press. You see the fruit come up, and you say either the next one will be ripe or the next one will be unripe. And they do it 100 times. Because of the number of subjects available, we had to pick a smaller number of resources. So what we decided to do was compare fruits with coins. Because people in both of these places, UCLA students and Shuar people, both know the idea of a coin toss. We checked that. And of course, they both know what fruits are. And so what we found was, again, hot hand in both places. If anything, the Shuar people were more hot hand than the Americans. Again, we replicated this finding. UCLA students guessing coins, this was, of all the conditions, this was the least hot-handed, but nevertheless, they still have hot hand about it. And so essentially what you see here is good evidence that this is a universal feature of human cognition, that it's a kind of default. We could not get rid of it. And my colleague Andreas and I have done this many times with many resources. We cannot get anything but hot hand, no matter what. So it's a very strong psychological default bet that our brains make. And it's pretty clear that it doesn't come from basketball. It's somehow more deeply entrenched. And it can be affected. So we see that UCLA students can get away from this bet, but not all the way. So learning about coins can help you get rid of it a little bit, but not completely, which probably partially explains why people gamble, stock market, and so on. And so we have a small grant now to actually study gamblers using this technique to see if people who have gambling problems have more hot hand than people who don't. So this would be an interesting case where, again, it's, you know, you could call it domain general. It's certainly general in the sense that it goes across many resources, but if we're right, it has more specific origins in something like a foraging psychology. And it's a bet that comes from the evolutionary past that can be applied to the modern world, and that in many cases now, it's actually wrong. But in some cases, it might help you. So people who are using foraging, actually doing foraging, it still helps them. Okay, because of time, I'm going to skip over this and just give you some concluding thoughts. So it seems to be the case, both from experimental work and just from our experience of being in the world every day, our evolved mechanisms are not paralyzed by the modern world. Okay, so that blue screen, failure to compute that I showed you, just doesn't happen. There's very few cases in the world where our brains are unable to process what's going on. The brain is able to react what's happening in the world. So the interesting question is not the question that we might have asked at the beginning, which is, evolved mechanisms are frozen in time and completely rigid. We need domain general mechanisms to deal with the modern world. Instead, it seems quite likely that adaptations are interacting with the modern world. And so for future research in evolutionary psychology, which I hope that many of you will do, the interesting questions are, You know, sometimes these mechanisms give us adaptive behavior. So Snoop Dogg is perfectly able to do a performance with Tupac even though he's dead. Sometimes they'll produce maladaptive behavior. So the hot hand makes us have bad intuitions about basketball or about gambling or coin tosses. They're both the result of adaptations. And the real questions are, what are the details of how those adaptations interact with the world? So when do we get adaptive behavior? When are we able to successfully interact with the world? And then from a mechanistic point of view, which is our job as scientists to figure out actually how the little stuff in the mind is working, the questions are how is that produced? What kind of a bet is our mind making? And why? And why can be a difficult question to answer because we're asking questions about the past. So Andreas and I have conjectured that hot hand comes from foraging. We don't know that. And we'll probably never be able to prove it. But I think that by suggesting that, the older idea was that it comes from basketball. Right? And we've shown pretty convincingly that it's not from basketball. And what we need to do is think about, well, where does it come from? Foraging is one idea, and I think it's quite plausible, but maybe there are others. And so your job is to come up with hypotheses like that and then go out and get the data to test them. And hopefully this has given you some ideas for ways to investigate the evolution of the mind as a flexible organ, but that is nevertheless specialized and one that is not necessarily frozen in the past but capable of dealing with evolutionary novelty. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Clark, for such an interesting talk. Tenemos entonces tiempo ahora para algunas preguntas. Ustedes pueden formularlas en castellano, porque Clark entiende castellano, o si lo desean en inglés, como ustedes prefieran. Así que, no sé si alguien quisiera comenzar formulando alguna pregunta. Sí.
Clark, yo tenía una curiosidad cuando estabas comentando acerca de que supuestamente podemos reconocer las letras porque, o sea, en lo que pues percibimos del mundo hay características que se parecen a ellas, ¿no? Uh-huh. Entonces, en el caso de alfabetos que no son los nuestros, digamos, los ideogramas chinos u otras letras, se habrían evolucionado porque para ese contexto cultural funcionaban esas imágenes, digamos. O sea, no sé si me dejo entender bien.
Sí, entiendo. Claro que no es mi estudio, es de Changizi, pero lo que dicen en el estudio es que la muestra de idiomas que usaron en el estudio era incluía también, por ejemplo, chino, japonés. Entonces, incluía idiomas o sistemas de escritura que eran como tú dices. Pero también dicen que si uno vea los... Si tú investigas cómo eran las idiomas antes, por ejemplo, la idioma de los maya, que era hieroglyphics, ¿no? Uh-huh. Están, o sea, los idiomas cuando empezaron tenían más formas de letras que no eran así. O sea, al principio eran más complejos y no obedecían el mismo principio. Pero después de tiempo, los que no funcionan bien con nuestro sistema visual, bueno, se extinguieron. Y él piensa, Changizi dice que puede ser que los idiomas como chino, japonés, están evolucionando hacia formas más regulares. Y no soy experto, pero creo que es así, porque en algunos casos hay dos formas de escribir. Por ejemplo, en japonés hay una forma complicada y otra forma que no es complicada, y está cambiando. Entiendo que en Japón está empezando a ser más común escribir en la forma más simple. Entonces, si es verdad, puede ser que there's a phenomenon, cultural inertia. So people don't like to change. And so it's the case that when things appear, it can take a long time historically for them to change because people like to do things the same way. And so cultural evolution can be a slow process. So if there's multiple forms of writing, it can people can want to cling to the old one, but it's quite possible that those more complicated letter systems will gradually become simpler.
¿Alguna otra pregunta? Por ahora. Yo tengo un par de preguntas generales que quisiera hacerte. De hecho, me parece que hay cierto acuerdo en que uno de los rasgos característicos del cerebro humano es su plasticidad, ¿no es verdad? Y esto ha garantizado que el Homo sapiens pueda realmente adaptarse a una serie de entornos, incluyendo el entorno moderno, que es sumamente diferente del de la sabana africana donde evolucionamos hasta hace más o menos 100.000 años, ¿no? ¿Tú piensas o hay estudios que muestren si es que la plasticidad cerebral del Homo sapiens es notablemente diferente a la plasticidad cerebral de los chimpancés, por ejemplo? Esa es una pregunta. Y la otra pregunta que quisiera hacerte es esta. Hay quienes piensan que el cerebro humano dejó de crecer, el lóbulo frontal dejó de crecer más o menos hace 200.000 años, ¿no? Si el lóbulo frontal siguiese creciendo, sería sumamente contraadaptativo, ¿no es verdad? O sea, hace 3 millones de años el cerebro humano medía, como hemos conversado antes, 450 centímetros cúbicos más o menos, ahora mide 1.450 centímetros cúbicos, entonces ha crecido. Pero ya no puede crecer más, porque el parto sería inviable, el embarazo sería inviable, cambiaría toda la anatomía. Entonces, aparentemente el cerebro ya no está creciendo. Ahora, la pregunta es, las funciones cerebrales, las funciones cognitivas del cerebro están cambiando desde hace 200.000 años. ¿Tú dirías que hay una modificación significativa o tú dirías que el cerebro de un homínido de hace 200.000 años es fundamentalmente, en lo esencial, idéntico al de un bebé recién nacido de hoy, ¿no?
Bueno, voy a contestar en inglés. Sure. Some complicated words that I don't know in Spanish. So the first question, plasticity. What's interesting is, so in order to talk about the degree of plasticity, you would have to do something like, you'd have to use experimental logic. So do the same manipulation in a human and a chimpanzee and see what the outcome was to be able to compare how much plasticity there is. And to my knowledge, there's no comparisons like that. We certainly know that plasticity is not unique to humans because almost all of the famous studies of brain plasticity are actually done with other animals, especially monkeys. Macaques are a very common laboratory animal to use. And so one of the early studies that is extremely famous is a study by Sir and Leamy where they showed that you can route input from the ears into an area where auditory input doesn't usually go, and you see that that brain area will become like a hearing area. And that was done in monkeys. So we know that there's that plasticity. Yeah, so it's a very interesting study. And in fact, there are people who are doing this work with humans, people like Michael Merznick at UC San Francisco, looking at things like hearing aids and the role, so prosthetic devices, that there have been a variety of attempts now to do things like create a device that will send electrical stimulation that has the pattern, of course, that the pattern that you would get from the firing of auditory neurons or visual neurons into the brains of people who are deaf or blind, and finding out can their brains wire up in a way that and the answer is to some degree yes. In fact, you can even get people to do things like see using touch. There are, it's very crude, but there are devices, there's one study that I heard of, because your tongue has a lot of sense, touch sense on it, there was a device where it takes a video camera and turns the pixels of the video input into tiny little electrical stimulation that goes on the tongue. And you give that to blind people and you let them use it for a while and they can actually see eventually using their tongue. So they can know that there's an object on their left or an object on their right, feeling it through their tongue. Plasticity, and that's actually very, I think, consistent with the idea that I suggested of a reaction norm where it's not necessarily entirely destined that your visual area will develop here or here. It's that there's that potential to develop in, as a visual area if you get a certain kind of input that might result from, say, activation of certain genes. It's consistent with the idea of plasticity, but also with the idea of specialization. So we don't know about the difference between humans and chimps in terms of plasticity. We do know, as you said, that we have much larger cerebral cortex. And one of the things that's interesting with there that I just wanted to mention is that our intuition, again, with this general purpose specific distinction, we have a strong intuition that as our brains get bigger, and it's actually quite common to hear that the neocortex is a general purpose information processing system. And when it got bigger in humans, we just get more and more general purpose processing. What's interesting, though, is that the bigger that you make the brain, the more modular it gets, not the less. Mm-hmm. And one reason is architectural. So if your definition of modularity is lots of local connections, like little groups of cells that are all interacting with each other, if you think about it, if you have a very small bunch of neurons, they can all be connected to each other very easily. The more neurons that you make, the harder it is for every single neuron to be connected to every other neuron. And so as you make a bunch of neurons bigger, it has to become more localized, the interactions, just by physical constraints of the space. And there are studies using network analysis that show that the bigger your brain gets, the more localized the networks need to be, suggesting that bigger brains actually have more modularity rather than less. Interesting thing. I mean, how that gets selected for is whether there are pre-specified modules or not is another question, but certainly architecturally it's more modular. And that's consistent with the idea that as you make a brain bigger, and people in different fields think about this different ways, comparative neuroanatomists see flexibility as coming from greater modularity. So if you have a brain that carves off one area into speech processing and another area into vision, that actually has more flexibility than a brain that tries to use the same neurons to do both things. Because a lot of times, and we know this through, if you think about how computers work, right, our computers are more modular than ancestral computers, and they're more flexible, right, because you can cut and paste, and there's one program that does cut and paste, and there's another program that does the printing, and it's not the same. The more applications you have, the more stuff you can do. And that may apply to the brain as well. There's one thing I wanted to mention, too. You talked about brain size. There's this idea of relaxed selection. So when you have medical interventions, things that might have affected fitness before might not affect fitness now. So things like vision problems, you can have glasses, or you can have contact lenses, or you can have laser surgery, which means that people who, you know, if it was somebody having to kill a toucan for dinner and they couldn't see very well, it might affect their fitness. You have a medical intervention that makes it so that your eyes work fine. You don't have selection on that anymore. With the size of the birth canal, we know that presents a problem for the evolution of larger brains because the pelvis is a certain size. The baby can't come out if the brain is too big, and there's constraints due to the anatomy of walking. But now we have cesarean sections. Right? And so a large-brained baby that might have killed the mother and itself in birth before, we actually don't know. With now, and it seems, I'm not an expert on medical history, but cesareans are becoming more and more common. I don't know if they're actually the modal kind of birth now, but eventually it may be that most people have birth that way. If that's true, then there won't be selection on brain size anymore. And whether there's a benefit, fitness benefit to bigger brains, I don't know, but it certainly could be the case that we culturally, technologically change the evolutionary environment that makes it such that bigger brains can evolve. Don't know. It's a speculation. Yeah.
Thanks, Dr. Parr. That was incredible and very amazing. I have a question about the experiment about the UCLA students.
Yeah.
I was thinking about optimism and negativism and that aspect, you know. How can those be transferred into the experiment? And I don't know, the students can also react in a very different, have a different response, you know? Also, I believe that the exercise can be transferred from the outside in and the inside out, because it's the way we live right now. It's the situations, culture, and the world that affect us, and vice versa. So yeah, that was my.
Did you say exercise?
Yeah, the experiment, the exercise.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, with the fruits and the coins.
Yeah. Okay. Well, so the first thing that you were asking about, essentially you're asking about individual differences in, say, optimism, right?
Yes.
So some students, there's been so much research on hot hand by other people that there may well be, I don't know of all the studies, there are so many of them, hundreds, there may well be studies looking at individual differences where, and what you would need is a relatively... For any individual differences study, you need a much larger sample size, because you would need to do, say, have hundreds of students doing this test, and then you would have to give them a separate, maybe a scale like the kind that social psychologists use to judge optimism or something like that. And yes, you might find that maybe those people would have more hot hand. They'd think that they were more lucky when they get a hit. I don't know if that's true. I mean, as I mentioned, we are going to look at individual differences in gambling at a casino. My colleague Andreas works in New York, and there's a casino near him, and he's now gotten it set up where we're going to test people coming into the casino using this task to see if there's individual differences as a function of gambling propensity. I think you could maybe say that people who go to casinos a lot, there's a certain kind of optimism. It might not be the same as other kinds of optimism. It may be more pathological. I don't know. But yeah, it's an interesting question. And the other thing is, so you mentioned that the study itself could sort of feed back into the minds of the students. It's very interesting that people know that coins are random and they can't do this. And there's several ways of doing this. So here's an exercise you can do if you're ever teaching a class and you want to demonstrate this phenomenon. Divide the students into two groups and maybe put them in two different rooms, okay? Have one of them flip a coin and write down, you know, heads for H and T for tails, and just do it 100 times and just write on the board. So they use the coin to do it. Have another group of students attempt to write down a series of letters that they think looks like it was random. You see what I'm saying? So there's no coin. They just have to say HT, HT, HHHT. Think about how you would do it, right? So you would know there's got to be a few streaks of two or three. And so you would try to, if you're the teacher, you come back into the room and you have to guess which one was the coin and which one wasn't. You can do it every time. Because, so one thing, for example, is it's actually quite common to have four heads in a row. It's quite common. If you look at a sequence of 100, there will be four, there will be five. When it's made by students trying to pretend to be a coin, right, they might say, they'll have a bunch of streaks of two and then some of three, but they won't put six or seven, when in fact, in a streak of 100 coins, it's actually quite likely to have a streak like that. And so you can look at the board and immediately just look for the one that has long stretches of hits, and that will be the one that was actually made by the coin. So, and that's interesting, because somehow people think that the coin is going to be more alternating than it really is, even though consciously. So there have been many studies where you try to get people to make random numbers. People are very bad at making random numbers. And so even if they've participated in the experiment, it's an interesting question whether it'll actually make them eventually get to 0.5 guesses on the hot hand. I don't know. But it seems very hard to remove.
¿Alguna otra pregunta?
Bueno, yo vengo del campo de la salud mental y desde ese campo tengo una curiosidad, ¿no? Digamos, las personas que trabajamos en el tema de psicopatología, básicamente desde una perspectiva explicativa de la psicopatología del desarrollo, pensamos que a la base de muchos trastornos, sobre todo, por ejemplo, los trastornos de personalidad, hay un tema de inflexibilidad, ¿no? La incapacidad de utilizar los recursos y adaptarse a situaciones nuevas, ¿no? Digamos, está a la base del funcionamiento general de este tipo de patologías. Me daba curiosidad saber cuál podría ser el aporte de, por ejemplo, la perspectiva evolucionista, ¿no?, en la explicación, ¿no es cierto?, de esta incapacidad para utilizar los recursos en situaciones nuevas, porque nuestras explicaciones tienen que ver con lo que ocurre en la ontogénesis, ¿no? Patrones de crianza, vínculos, condicionamientos, cualquiera sea el lenguaje o la orientación teórica, ¿no? Entonces quería saber un poco qué pensabas de eso.
Bueno, so I think there's increasing research on pathologies, on psychological pathologies from an evolutionary point of view, but I think the overarching principle, again, it's not really my area of expertise, but just from general evolutionary thinking, a very basic principle is that it's when you have a system that's well designed, it's much easier to break it than to make it better. In fact, you know, if any artifact like that computer, it's trivial to break it. So it's very easy to make it not work right. It's very hard to make it work better. And it's an interesting thing about human brains and human development in general. It's got a property that biologists call robusticity, which is actually what I was referring to with the blue screen. A computer, it's very easy to have it just fail to boot up or break. Human brains and bodies are incredibly resistant to damage. So, but when there is damage through a genetic mutation, say, or extreme, you know, maybe obviously most pathologies are on a spectrum, but in extreme cases of abnormal developmental environments, you know, what you'd expect is that the system will be dysfunctional in certain ways, because it's, especially with a mutation, it can be quite easy to, it disrupts, say, development of neurons or cell transmission or something like that. It's going to have widespread effects throughout the brain. An interesting question is, as you know, looking at dissociations has been a very important source of evidence for thinking about functional design. And the logic of that has been, well, in something like autism, for example, you have a dissociation of social cognition from other forms of cognition. Prosopagnosia, face recognition deficits, you can't see faces, you can't recognize faces, but you can recognize other categories of object. I think those are cases where, in some sense, as scientists, there's been some luck in a very perverse way, because obviously those people are very unlucky, that the damage was so selective, because really you might expect a lot of cases for the damage to be much more general. And when you take something like autism, people have looked for genetic causes of autism, and it seems that there's just lots of things going wrong. I think you were asking about the inflexibility of people with pathologies. It could be that my view would be, my guess, and this is conjecture, is that flexibility is flexibility is something that requires specialization, strangely. I gave the example of computers. To have a very flexible computer, our computers are getting more and more flexible over time. It's because we put more specialized things in. To get flexibility is a very, very special and unusual thing biologically. And it runs counter to the way people think in psychology. So that view that I put up of sort of the modules and then the central thing, if you really believe that, right, that the specialization is around the outside and there's this flexible middle part, if you take away those modules from the outside, the whole thing should get more and more flexible. that's probably not what happens. As you remove specialized abilities, humans probably get less flexible. So if you were to remove language abilities, I would expect less overall cognitive flexibility. If you remove almost any specialization you can think of inside the mind, it's likely to lead to a person that's able to do fewer things. And so I would think it would be a probably a pretty widespread thing in psychopathology, where if you have, even if it's a selective deficit of the person, like they have a linguistic deficit but not a general intelligence deficit, it's going to filter into general flexibility. And if you have things like mood disorders, anxiety, my guess is that will make you a lot less flexible because you'll be fixated on certain things and less able to disengage. So I think that, again, is a little counterintuitive, and it runs counter to the idea that you have just flexibility as one general thing and then you have all these specialized mechanisms. I would guess that the flexibility comes from the interaction of specialized mechanisms, and as you remove them, the whole system will get less flexible.
Just a comment and a question. My comment is the following. When you showed us
the picture of the two rappers.
Yes.
And you said something like, our eyes don't know that the other guy is dead.
Right.
Right? And so the image is processed as if Tupac was just a living person. And so I just thought that maybe something like that happens with language. We use referential phrases to talk about things around us, like the rock or yeah. My mother or this desk or so. And we also use referential phrases for things that are abstract, like my intelligence or his death
or justice.
Or justice, right? Or things like that. And the grammar doesn't seem to treat them differently, right? And so maybe we can imagine this is absolutely speculative, that in the origins, referential phrases were just used to talk about concrete things, but our brain just doesn't notice that now we're using it for abstract things, right? That's just a comment. And the my question is, I didn't understand what you meant by genes turned on.
Oh.
You talked about an experiment of the bumblebee, and we mm-hmm. saw brains, images of brains. But I don't understand what do you mean by genes turning on?
Okay.
Thanks.
Sure. First of all, the first idea that you suggested is absolutely a wonderful idea. I think there's a lot to that. The terminology that I didn't use but is frequently used in evolutionary psychology is the distinction between proper and actual function, or proper and actual domains. So that the ancestral circumstances that shape the evolution of something are its proper domain, but then the actual domain can include a broader range of things. There's many examples. I mean, the easy ones are in vision, where you would think human faces are the proper domain of a face recognition system, but you could imagine I can still process the face of a guy in the Transformers movie, right, that's made out of a car or something. Even though that's not a natural stimulus, it maps on well enough. And your idea about reference, I think, is really great, that it seems plausible that reference capacities originally evolved to refer to existing objects and things like that. But then once you have that ability, you can refer to abstract entities. So there's things like something like justice, where it's not even an object, or time, maybe something like that, which exists but isn't, or to imaginary things like unicorns or something where it doesn't exist. And once you have that ability, it allows you to, I mean, that's a very interesting topic of what that allowed our minds to do in terms of inventing things. I'm reminded of things, you know, various kinds of cultural inventions that come from the freeing of reference and things like that from the actual world. So you still have an argument in the United States about whether we should have, for every dollar, where there should be some gold somewhere, mm-hmm. right? Because the intuitive idea is there's some object somewhere that the money should correspond to. But most historians of economics think that it was a major innovation to not have currency attached to a specific object anymore, which took some kind of a cultural invention to realize. Let's just make it an abstract quantity, and there can be as much of it or as little of it as we want. And you can, I can imagine many kinds of innovations, cultural innovations that change society that come from these kinds of abstract thinking. So I don't know of people who have really investigated that from an evolutionary point of view, but it would be a great thing for someone to investigate. What I meant by turning genes on and off was, the technical term is gene expression. So, right, as you know, every cell in your body has the same DNA, right? But the phenotype, the actual what the thing is like, is the cells in my eye are not the same as the cells in my ear, right? They have the exact same DNA. The reason is because different genes are being expressed or were expressed during development in the cells of your eye versus the cells of your hand or whatever. And so when you think about it, it doesn't take very long to realize development has to be a process whereby different tissues in the body express different genes, that there's some way that the genes are acting differently in your liver than they are in your heart or in your brain. And I was making the suggestion and showing some evidence that, so what's the older way, and many people still think that this in neuroscience, of thinking about the brain was, a neuron is a neuron. And the neurons have wiring up rules. And so the way, and this is the philosophy of connectionism in psychology, where you model, all neurons are identical. They all have identical rules for how to change their properties as a function of input. And so all of the content of the brain comes from those general properties that are true of all neurons, plus the input coming from the world. But what if the neurons up here, right, have some different rules than the neurons back here for how to change their properties as a function of inputs? And this is what I was suggesting with, say, when you send auditory input to an area of the brain that doesn't normally get auditory input. We don't know, but there could be some developmental programs that say, oh, this firing pattern looks like sound, and so I'm going to turn on the genes that I would turn on to make this be a sound area of the brain. Right? And so it's very speculative, but this is why I put up that study by Oldham and colleagues that show that that there's very different genes activated in different parts of the brain. So it's not the case that the brain is necessarily genetically, in terms of gene expression, it's not just one homogeneous organ such that all neurons are the same. The neurons in different parts of the brain could be doing very different things to input that comes in. And it seems to me that the evidence is weighing heavily for that at this point, and the problem is with gene expression is what I can't wait for is an MRI machine, right? So you can put somebody in a brain mapping machine that shows basically the flow of blood to different parts of the brain while they're thinking, right? And we use that to look at things like the visual word form area and face recognition. If we could get one that shows what genes are turned on and off, that would be amazing. But at present, you have to kill the organism and take its brain and look at the proteins, for example, that are expressed in those different areas of the brain in order to do this. So we still can't see, for example, are the genes that are turned on in areas that are processing language different than the genes that are turned on in the areas that are doing visual processing during development? I would bet money that that will be true, but we don't know. And we'll know from other mammals. I mean,
So this is during development?
During development.
But during how many years?
Well, I've had some conversations with people who do these expression studies. So there's different timescales. So we can think about development happening over years. And there's a bunch of evidence now that Pablo was referring to, that even in adults we have substantial brain plasticity. So it's not like there's a window of plasticity that ends. But certainly these expression patterns could happen over long periods of time. But when we think about the metaphor of digestion, we know that when you eat food, genes are turned on So if I eat a sandwich right now, 10 minutes later, there will be genes turned on in my stomach that were not turned on 10 minutes ago. There will be expressing proteins to digest the bread, right? And that happens on a time scale of minutes or hours or something like that. And then once I'm finished digesting it, right, because it's energetically expensive to express an enzyme to digest carbohydrates. So once there's no carbohydrates, then those genes become downregulated and they stop producing that enzyme. Who knows in the brain if all of a sudden I'm angry? What if genes start becoming expressed when I'm angry that were not expressed when I was asleep, right? I think certainly awake versus asleep, there's likely to be differences in gene expression. But even, I don't know, in certain kinds of psychological states could have gene expression associated with them, neurotransmitters and things like that. I talked to somebody who does gene regulation, and they thought that that was kind of a crazy idea. So maybe it is. But it seems quite plausible to me that I don't see any reason to think that we couldn't have much shorter term differences in gene expression as a function of like stress. You're stressed today, and so you have certain genes turned on today that are not going to be turned on when you relax tomorrow. We just don't know. But my guess would be that there's probably genes are probably playing roles like this all the time, and it's not just the case that we come with DNA and it's expressed the same way over the course of our life. I would guess, given what we know from other animals, that it's very dynamic. And that the environment is, it's not just the genes are just by themselves and the environment doesn't matter. They're heavily designed to interact with the environment, including informational environment inside our minds, which would be a new frontier of research that I think is hard to do right now, but would be really interesting to see what the next couple decades hold.
Bueno, muchísimas gracias. Claro que ha estado realmente interesante tu conferencia. Muchísimas gracias a ustedes por venir a Estudios Generales Letras y al Grupo Interdisciplinario de Investigación Mente y Lenguaje. Así que será hasta otra ocasión. Gracias.